Welcome back to EOS Radio. This is show number two, and we're talking TELOS today. You know, the TELOS project launched recently, or they're doing their launch sequence just recently, and it's really got my attention. It's been talked about for months now. I would say pretty soon after the EOS mainnet launch, we started hearing talk about TELOS, and a lot of people were confused about it. A lot of people didn't understand what it was or why it was being launched. And the more I've learned about the project and just about the necessity in competition and friendly competition in the EOS.io blockchain space, the bigger fan I became of TELOS. And so here we are, EOS.radio live number two, and I wanted to bring on a panel that we could chat about TELOS. Of course, my co-host, Zane from the Freedom Proxy is here. Thank you so much for joining us again, Zane.
Hi, everybody.
Of course. We got Beth Farnham of goodblock.io. Hey, Beth.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thank you.
We've also got Douglas Horn. I think everyone knows Douglas from Good Block. Thank you for joining us, Douglas. And we've got Rob from EOS Detroit, who is a backup BP on the EOS mainnet and one of the main BPs in TELOS. So, hey, Rob, thanks for joining us, man. It's good to see you again.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Ash.
Yeah, man. So I guess, Beth, let's start with you, because I think most other people may be familiar with Rob and Douglas. What is Good Block? How does it tie into TELOS? And what is your role there?
Sure. People don't know me too much. I stay silently in the background, pushing buttons, making things happen. The real power behind the face. See, I knew Douglas would agree to that. We have a leadership team at Good Block that is basically Douglas, James Davis, and myself, and we kind of handle everything and anything that involves work that's happening at Good Block, as well as kind of our role within the TELOS community. So I basically do a little bit of everything. Sadly, I'm not a developer. There's a great team of work doing great work there, but everything else that's going on, I have a little hand in. I have a lot of experience with organizational development, so I've been working a lot with the TLG members on developing the TELOS Foundation and what that might look like going forward. So a little bit here, a little bit there.
Yeah, that's great. And Douglas, go ahead and introduce yourself for people who, for some reason, have been living under a rock and don't know you. And how did you come up with that idea of TELOS?
All right, well, those are kind of two questions. So hi, my name is Douglas Horn. I founded Good Block with Beth and James, two very good friends who I knew from other phases of my life and had worked with for years. We started out as app developers, little asterisks. I'm going to call them apps because I think we should call them apps. I think calling them apps gets in the way of the real users we want to get. So if you're like, why is he calling them apps? That is why. So we started Good Block to develop apps, games, and some other really fantastic blockchain uses. I have been in blockchain for a while, and worked through under the radar, intentionally under the radar for quite a while, and then TELOS came along, and I figured I had to crawl out from behind the rock cloak and actually, you know, put a public face on so that people could see that this is a people-based project. So I'm in the kind of unfamiliar place for the last 5 months of getting to talk to a lot of people. It's been great, but apologize if I'm not as polished as Beth.
And Rob, hey, welcome back, man. I always see you at conferences. You're always just such a great guy with full insight. Introduce yourself real quick for
So I'm Rob Konsdorf, also known as Rob Rigo. I've been working in delegated proof of stake blockchains for a while. So been around since the BitShares days, and more recently pulled together a team to launch EOS Detroit. So I'm the founder and CEO of EOS Detroit, and we're running infrastructure for EOS, Warbly, and soon to be TELOS. We were approached by Douglas to be a launch partner of TELOS. So we joined the TELOS launch group early on and started working on it. We were impressed. I was personally impressed by Douglas and his team's professionalism and vision. I felt it was one of the stronger projects being envisioned as far as like chain protocols go. And I saw that Douglas wanted to really tackle some hard problems. So I came along for the ride, and so did our team. So Adam worked on governance for TELOS and Phil did a lot of managing the live streams and stuff like that. So
cool. Yeah. Thank you. So let's dive in here, because I know there's quite a few, let's not call them problems, but things to figure out in the EOS main chain, that it looks like, seeing that TELOS is a smaller community, is able to tackle some of those problems earlier and with more efficiency. And this is one of the reasons that I'm really excited about TELOS. You're definitely not shy on Twitter and talking about like, hey, we've changed our tokenomics. You know, we've changed the cap. I think that may have been the very first thing that I heard about TELOS, is we're going to do this airdrop, but we're going to try to remove the whales, and we're going to limit the number of tokens that every TELOS Genesis block gets. Douglas, can you walk us through like what was the logic behind that, and how you think that adds value to the TELOS chain?
Sure. That's a great question, Ash. Yeah, I think that's the thing that most people picked up on. And there was a lot of, you guys are communists. You guys are well, there's a lot of misunderstanding in the beginning, which, you know, I think it's actually really smart to be skeptical about new projects. And I'm very happy that there's a lot, you know, that people have learned more about us. There's a little bit less skepticism now. That is based on, so that tokenomic change is based on the this idea that I honestly, deep down, think, I'm sorry to say, it's not going to be possible. It's going to be extremely difficult to solve the problems around, you know, around the hyper concentration of voting when the solution mechanism is voting. Mm. Right. So, so, I mean, that's the, okay. Thanks. Next question. You know, I mean, that could be the answer, right? So starting with that thesis, which I think is pretty solid, I tried to get around that, and I could not get around that. So starting with that, and also with seeing the passion for this project from a ton of people who, you know, maybe have put like their, you know, a big chunk of their life savings into EOS, and still are not going to have a voice in something that they thought, mm-hmm. when they bought in, they were going to get a voice on, you know,
right.
And so I don't want to disenfranchise that middle class of people who are really passionate and believe in EOS and EOSIO. And what would happen, I feared, was that they would just move on to something that fit them better.
Right? Yeah. And where they felt actually represented. I mean, because
right, anytime you see disenfranchisement amongst voters, you see voter apathy and you know, in any system. So that's what that would be our future as well in the EOS community. So I wanted to think, I believe though, that the people, we already have an amazing group of people who are passionate about EOS and EOSIO, mm-hmm. and we're lucky to have that. And so I thought, how do we preserve that? How do we keep these people in the game? From block producers to developers to everyone else, because there's a lot, everyone who says, is it EOS or TELOS is blind to the fact that there are many, 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 many other options out there, mm-hmm. for really progressive blockchains. Right. I mean, that's how I see it. That's the context I see it in. So how do we keep these people together on the EOS promise? I actually am a huge believer of it just for technical reasons. Right. Because it's hit a block time. It's hit a lot of buttons. Like here's what EOS has done great. It's with a half second block time. It's the fastest you could ever expect to go on a global network due to the speed of light. Right. So we're not going to get faster. It's also the slowest something could be and still conform to user expectations of a button push equals an action.
Right.
Sorry, this is my TELOS cough. I've had it for 4 months.
Is that because you're staying up for 18 hours a day working on
time? Sometimes, yeah. So
is there a computer virus joke in there somewhere?
Probably. So, okay. So it has this amazing thing where it fits. EOS can fit the consumer needs both in UX and also in the protections right? We don't have a long, you know, a long strange thing to most people, right? A strange key that if you lose, you've lost forever. We have accounts. People are much more familiar with the paradigm, and we can build an application layer on top of that paradigm that they're going to be even more more familiar with, right? Which is not not going to happen on Ethereum, right? You're never going to get a sort of a credit card user friendly kind of version. So there's so much going for it, and I thought it had a few things that could still be fixed, and I just thought it actually. And so that tokenomics thing is, how do we fix that? And how do we make it so we empower the middle class voters and the little guy and a lot of people who are probably, you know, going to be super impassioned, you know, but also don't ignore the fact that the people who did invest in it a lot may also be fantastic, you know, people in the EOCO world, right? Sure. We're really just trying to, so with tokenomics, we tried to have the least restrictive cap we could. And sort of hit that and hit the seam right there between alienating the fewest giant holders, mm-hmm. and empowering the most, you know, middle class holders.
Right. And it's not that Wells couldn't eventually form on Telos. It's just that they don't get their corresponding EOS tokens. They're forced to buy into the marketplace.
That's true. But that is true. Like the people say, well, you can get whales, right? But they're just a very short sort of like math thought experiment, yeah. Right? If like, so we're going to have 342 and change million tokens on EOS, right? Mm. Telos. So if somebody, if these you know, passionate people could get together and buy 100 million Telos, mm-hmm. right? I'm sure that's what we're talking about. We're talking about, oh my gosh, you know, 5 or 10 people have bought 100 million Telos.
Right.
Well, that would be 5 or 10 people controlling, you know, 30% of the token supply, right? Right now basically at launch, we had those same 10 people controlling, you know, 60% of the token supply on EOS. It's the nightmare of decentralization that people are worried about happening someday, maybe on Telos, would be an unachievable dream,
right?
Of decentralization, sure. from EOS, right?
Right. Yeah. It's like,
you don't always have to be perfect, right? Sometimes you just have to.
You almost never have
better
to.
Than the other option.
Yeah, you know, just life in general progresses iteratively, so there is no perfection here. Yeah. I love it.
That's huge. Iteration is everything, and I hope you'll ask about that. I don't want to hijack things.
Sure, but I want to get to Beth over here. Beth, talk to us about the community, because I know you're in the community and you're as not a dev, and I love having more non-devs in this space. You know, we need more people with different types of skill sets. We have all these nerds running around programming and setting up these technical systems. And if, you know, I've always thought that if blockchain is successful when 13-year-old girls in South Korea are using it every day. So what's been your experience there?
I don't know what you mean about nerds running around. I've never seen that. you know, there's a couple of great points there. One thing I'd like to say real quick in regards to what Douglas said and was mentioned in the beginning is it's a huge testament to kind of the passion and the intellect of the blockchain community and the crypto community, you know, within the first few weeks of the EOS launch to be able to look at Telos and embrace it. You know, there was definitely the pushback, there was definitely the misconceptions, but there was so many people that were just willing to actually dig in and learn about it and ask the questions and join the conversation, which I think is a really great testament to the community as a whole. That was really great to kind of see that come forward. I would love to see 13-year-old girls all over the world using blockchain. Okay. Personally, my investment is a little bit more based in the touchy-feely nonprofit side of things. So I'm always looking for any way that we can kind of take the opportunity of blockchain and turn it for good. And part of that is kind of connecting to the community, seeing what the needs are, but also being able to communicate what's going on, what the opportunities are, whether it's education, which is a big component. So it's not a bunch of these, no offense, gentlemen, but middle-aged white men running around being nerds and geeks, that there's a whole nother world of people out there that can kind of get behind the technology.
I'm not middle-aged yet, Beth, even though you're watching.
You're the only, there's only, oh, I'm sorry, not in this particular group.
She met me.
Another call earlier.
But, I mean, here we are, a bunch of white guys with various stages of beards, right? And
I just shaved mine.
Actually, I like that. That's a nice
setup. Shout out to the white guys, though. We build a lot of awesome stuff and we get thrown under the bus a lot. And so we do
I'm not anti anyone.
For sure.
Yeah, this is a unification move for us too.
No doubt.
Trying to keep our narrative away from the polarity.
There you go. Well, yeah. That's for me, that's really kind of what it comes down to. And especially for us at GoodBlock, when we first started looking at EOS and then kind of came up with the incentive to move forward with TELOS was about accessibility. That this is a great technology and a great industry that everybody should have access to. So our commitment from the beginning has been about accessibility, whether it's being able to support an app that's somehow supporting something that's going on in a more undeveloped region, or whether it's just making it available for everybody to be a block producer or everybody to be able to vote fairly. It's about accessibility.
And ease of use. I mean, you know, in London, whenever Chestnut got second place at the hackathon, you know, we got the best UX UI. And we worked hard on it, but looking at it, it was, you know, a couple of hours that we spent just focused on our UX UI and interface and our user experience. And so I love people with softer skills coming in that can, they can actually make this stuff usable for real people. I mean, you know, right now I understand we're still in this very early stage and early adopters and nerds are the people that can like technically sit down and figure this stuff out. But if that's all we build, then blockchain and our communities are unsuccessful.
Sure. And it's a fine line right now. There's so much digital technology, like everybody's exposed to it from a very young age all over the world. So on some level, we're getting more savvy about it. But on other levels, we're so oversaturated with it that you almost have to make things user friendly. So understanding the audience and being able to almost work backwards sometime to figure out how information needs to be deployed and shared and trained so that it is actually user friendly for every single person is really important. That somebody doesn't have to sit down and know how to write some sort of fancy or read some sort of fancy script to be able to engage with the technology.
No way. If that's what someone has to do, then we've got a lot of work to do. I mean, this is what I've appreciated about some of the casinos that are popping up on EOS recently is some of them actually take the time to build a fairly beautiful user interface. And you can actually use it. When I show my friends like Bet Dice, for instance, and I hope to see tons of games and casinos and stuff like that come onto TELOS. But like people are like, I'm using a blockchain for the first time. I'm actually using a blockchain instead of just sending tokens from a wallet.
Can I add one thing in there, Ash?
Yeah, go ahead, man.
Along with what Beth was saying, how they're growing the community and making onboarding and just the overall experience great. They've got a good grant program. I didn't want to leave that out.
Oh, that's right.
It's really remarkable how, you know, we've seen CPU issues with EOS and we're having to go to like, say, Shintai to get some more CPU. And there's future advances that Block One's possibly having to help app providers give resources to users. But with your project, you're actually providing free net CPU just to help the dApp development on board. Can you give us more details on that? Because I was really excited to hear that.
Yeah, I actually, that's kind of the thing I'm most excited about now. It's funny because it's not a technical advancement at all, right? Here's what the GoodGrants program is. It turns out that altogether the people at GoodBlock did do quite a bit of work, and in the way our reward system is set up, which by the way, my hat is off to Rob for being one of the designers of that and really the driving force behind that. So we ended up with a lot, and with the idea that this is a chain that was founded on this idea of capping people who had too many. We thought that was a disconnect. And so what we decided to do was set up a program where we made that a community benefit, right? And so what's going to happen is the very largest part of what GoodBlock is going to get, and this is all be recorded on the blockchain in an hour probably, so I might as well say, we are setting aside 5 million TELOS in an account that's going to be used for at least 2 years solely to stake to new apps coming on board TELOS, so that they do not have to pay for their own net and CPU for the first year, and then with a tapering off tapering off after that of whatever they need, depending on the app. And the thinking here is that, again, I don't look at TELOS versus EOS at all, almost. I look at TELOS EOS, EOS TELOS, as against Ethereum and Tron and Neo and a bunch, you know, VeChain and a bunch of other projects, which are great projects, right? But when you're a developer, we're developers, you have to pick ahead of time where you're going to develop, right? And then there's a prayer, you hope it's going to be good, and you have a lot of development before you can turn out your product, right? So I thought, hey, the gas cost on EO on Ethereum is horrible for users, but it's great for app developers, because they aren't faced with this this huge cost of staking. And I know from talking to developers every day, that was coming up as their number one concern. Like, how many TELOS are going to need to deploy? How much RAM? How many of these things will we need to get on the system? And a lot of those conversations, because a lot of them are outside the EOSTO world, were people who were getting, you know, these go back to EOS before we even had TELOS. This go back to EOS, and people were asking these questions, and a lot of these conversations were ending up with like, wow, I love all the innovations, but to be honest, we're probably going to have to go on Ethereum or gas-based, some other, you know, or Tron or something like that, because we just can't come up with that money ahead of time. So I thought, well, here we have a bunch of money. We're not selling. We totally believe, you know, in TELOS. So how do we show the community that, number one, we're in for the long haul? Number two, we recognize the disconnect between capping everybody's accounts and then suddenly having a bunch, and then enabling apps to come on board. And so, especially apps from, you know, college students who are, you know, like, right, who have a great idea, or people in the third world, or developing nations, or even developing nation areas within the first world, right? I don't want to call out Detroit, but Rob and I had a big talk about this. There's a lot of pockets within the, sure, rich countries of non-richness, and those are exactly the people we want on board, right? Like, if you said, hey, no wealthy people will do this, but we'll use this, but the all the millennials and people in developing nations will use TELOS, I would go, great, okay.
Oh, you know? For sure. I mean, yeah. Get these younger people who have time, who are wasting time in public schools or spending way too much money, wasting time in college, but who are actually really curious about development, or just that they're a design person that knows a developer, and they can team up and get some free resources on TELOS and start experimenting. I think it's,
yeah, great. Come on, deploy. So I like we were saying with innovation or iteration, right? I think iteration is the key. I think having a lot of options, right? A lot of possible apps. I would rather, if you said, hey, you can have the top 20 apps, here's all the apps you're hearing about, you know, the top 20 deploy, right? Which is kind of what Block One is seems to be going after. I don't know, but, or you could have 150 apps that are going to be, you know, of vastly varying quality.
Sure.
You know, I would much rather, but you're going to give them a year, right? So that 5 million TELOS that we've set aside, because of the way the tokenomics on TELOS, is actually going to would have the staking power of approximately 20 to 25 million, right, tokens. So just because all the tokens in the exchange reserve are not going to be staked and things like that. Mm. So we can power that 100-150 apps to come on TELOS and not have to have those upfront costs. And we're looking at other ways to also get them some RAM. So then suddenly they get, all those developers get the advantages of EOCO, and with the low upfront costs of staking that they would get on a gas-based system. So that's the good grants. We don't take any, it's not VC. We don't take a stake in anybody. We ask really nothing in return, except that it's not an exploitive type app, mm-hmm, and that it deploys on TELOS.
Yeah. Yeah. Rob, you want to jump in there?
Oh yeah, I was just, Douglas had brought up Detroit. Along with Beth's accessibility statement earlier, I mean, our whole goal here is to create a bunch of early adopters that aren't your typical early adopters. And I think TELOS offers a great option. as Douglas said, you know, it may end up being a discount option for deploying apps compared to.
Yeah, why not?
And then if TELOS is high in demand because it's much more affordable, then, you know, the competing RAM pools between EOS and TELOS will actually start to normalize and reach an equilibrium where maybe, you know, both state chains are starting to mature. But for a while, TELOS is cheaper, so more apps go there. And then later on, you know, EOS might be a discount, so more apps will go there. So I think that's really going to, there's going to be a lot of really interesting forces at play just by having multiple options for developers.
Yeah, and just the scalability opportunities as well. It's like, hey, I'm this little bitty one-man team dApp app. I'm going to build where I can get a little bit of free resources and try to prove my model and prove my concept and try to get a couple of clients. And then if it blows up and I do great, then I'll replicate that on another chain and try to, you know, I think it's wonderful.
No one's leaving. They're not going to leave once they have built. They're only going to expand.
It's like expanding from this block to this block. It's like expanding from a block in New York to a block in Boston. You know,
it's the on ramp.
Yeah.
The on ramp. TELOS is the on ramp. Welcome.
The interoperability.
Welcome to EOS.
Allows us to just pick up and move. And as apps, you know, apps will start out on EOS or TELOS, but it may turn out that they grow so fast that they grow into their own chain.
Yeah, perhaps.
Because it demands it.
For sure.
And that's kind of been my vision. Like, you know, DAX or apps kind of start out on a chain and establish themselves and work out the kinks in their product or their framework or how, you know, the code, and then eventually grow into their own chain as necessitated by adoption.
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen
it's a much better vision, really, because I see all these apps coming out and saying for whatever reason, sometimes it's frustration, you know what, we're just going to launch our own chain. If an app launches, I think they have the sequencing completely backwards, because one of the things you can look at from all our like non-votes for a while is there's a lot of little gotchas involved in launching a successful chain. And why would an app with a great idea and probably competition to market, why would they want to do all that? Why would they want to take that on? You know, get the app working, get and then build and spin out, just like Rob said, spin out your own network when the needs demand it, when that's more economical, and then do an easy migration. I mean, that's a much better path, because launching a chain and an app is going to suck away all your energy for the app itself, which is the only part that's necessary, because there's three great chains, right?
Right, right. You know, you mentioned something earlier about, I can't remember who mentioned it, but Rob, I'd like to direct this question at you, since you are a block producer, the only block producer. Well, no, good blocks block producers, but inverse voting on TELOS is something that is very interesting to me, because, you know, we're having a bunch of governance questions and such on the EOS mainnet right now. And the idea, there's a couple things that I think are improvements that TELOS is bringing to the table here. The inverse voting, if you could help define that and talk about that a little bit.
But also
talking about how standby block producers are rotated in and what value you think that adds to the network. So I guess it's a little two-part question there.
Yeah, definitely. So I'll start with the first part, the inverse, the S curve. So what that does is requires each account to vote for more block producers, essentially, in order for the power of their vote to increase. And this is good when layered in with the compliance features of TELOS, because in order to be compliant on TELOS, you have to actually operate on the testnet and stagenet, and you also have to publish contact info and a number. You have to go through a more rigorous compliance mechanism. And so that'll help keep sock puppet VPs out, ideally. That combined with requiring that all accounts are actually voting for more producers will spread the vote around more. And ideally, I think the ideal here is it's harder to get in as a sock puppet, and it's also the picks may be more representative of popular support in TELOS due to the fact that the tokens imbue more representation per token as well.
Right.
So going back to that middle class Douglas referenced. And then on the topic of the rotating standbys, that's really great because we can actually test the standbys are production ready. This is something that we saw in Steam, on the Steam blockchain as well. The 21st block production slot was actually a wild card that was based on how much stake weighted voting you had. And it's done a little differently in Telos. It actually tests all the standbys over a specified period. And essentially it gives us the confidence that they're all ready to actually produce, that they all could be in the top 21 and have everything configured and ready to go. So it gives the network more information so that we can make better picks, I think. And I think the major reason why we didn't see that idea ported to EOS was actually something to do with incompatibility with the theoretical IBC functionality, inter-blockchain communication. But since it's still theoretical and we still just have one chain, I mean, this is a good experiment that Telos brings to bear. Mm-hmm. And perhaps in the future, there will be a design that allows both to work. So, that's, I don't know the details there. I do know that's one of the reasons or one of the justifications for why EOS didn't carry over this seemingly very valuable feature from Steam.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I really like the inverse weighting because I see some block producers who only vote for themselves, you know, and it gives them a leg up. And look, I'm not going to tell anyone what to do with their tokens. You're the token owner. You have the rights of the network and voting rights. But you can see where they would be incentivized to do more research or to network more and start supporting other block producers who they find valuable rather than just supporting themselves. You know, I understand it. Whenever your profit, whenever your revenue is directly tied to the number of votes you got and you're in competition with all their BPs, then you can give yourself a bit of what seems like a leg up if you only vote for yourself. So I love the S-curve. I really recommend the listeners go. And where can somebody read more about specifically that inverse weighting?
I believe it's in the Telos white paper. Douglas can correct me if I'm wrong. And that you can download at telosfoundation.io.
Awesome.
If you scroll down just a little bit, there's a link to the download of the white paper. On the point of profit, you know, for block producers and maybe trying to optimize that based on strategically allocating your votes, you know, I like to view EOS.io as a village. We're a big global village, and we're all working towards the long-term success of this village. So if other villagers are hungry and you're hoarding your food, we're not going to get very far together. So to me, you know, the long-term value of EOS actually increases if we vote strategically, even if it may hurt the number of tokens one person's making on the day-to-day by a marginal amount, they're probably gonna make less in the long run by having that short-term myopic view.
Right.
So that's why I think it's really good that we maintain the no kickback schemes culture. I don't support that. I think that it drains the system of value in the short term that would be more well-purposed investing in long-term projects.
No kickbacks, but I will for sure not turn away free Telos t-shirts. So just putting that out there. Another thing, Douglas, this is to you. I believe that another change that Telos had was that there's flat block producer pay. So you're not as in competition for the top block producer gets the most pay. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. So like Rob was saying, we talk about these in sort of layers of defense.
I think we might have lost Douglas there. If you want to jump in there, Rob, and talk about that.
Sure.
As a block producer, and maybe even comparing your experience being a block producer on the mainnet, EOS mainnet, and being a block producer on, you know, other chains.
Yeah. Yeah. So on the other chains, we actually earn tokens. Actually, I can say we have earned our first block rewards on EOS just this month.
I saw that.
We've gotten about 3 days worth of pay now, and we're currently above the pay threshold again.
Nice.
So we're trending up, and I have high hopes for our long-term prospects there. Warbly, we turned the chain on early November, and that's been humming along. They've got the KYC portal working, so we're getting paid there. And you know, Warbly has a lot of great things going for it too. However, this is the TELOS conversation. So, you know, we are optimistic about our prospects on TELOS. You know, our team has established leadership in the TELOS community in a number of ways. As Doug was saying, the block producer pay is a little flatter. So there's a little less direct competition between those in your class. So I like to think of the block producers, there's three classes: active, standby, and backup. Mm. Backup's when you're not getting paid as a standby. Standby is paid standby, and then active is you're signing the blocks.
Right.
So right now there may be hyper competition even within those classes on EOS, because the more you crawl up, it directly impacts your revenue. Mm. Whereas on TELOS, there's just like flat pay rates at each class. So as Douglas put it, it's a little bit more about, you know, it enables more of a community to form even within those classes of block producers. And I think Douglas might be back, so I can hand it back.
I think he is. I think I am. Sorry, I dropped. So like if you look at when the TELOS white paper came out, I looked at the difference, the delta between what the best paid BP on EOS was and the least paid that was still getting anything, and it was about 9-1.
Okay.
And that's a pretty big disparity. And I think there's actually a lot that's sort of packed into that. One thing is, you know, even in the block producers who are doing the job, they're doing the same work, but they're getting different pay. Not based on how well they're doing the job, but just basically on votes. And it creates a competition that's, I think, is less healthy, right? It can be a spectrum anywhere from like dog eat dog competition to centralization, right? And I think that, you know, we want to be close to this side, but we don't have to be all the way into like, you know, stab somebody in the back to get an extra couple of votes, right? That is also what empowers, by the way, the unhealthy parts of vote buying. So we don't actually have any hard, fast rules around vote buying, because I couldn't think of anything that would eliminate the bad parts of vote buying without disabling things like DACs and other groups from doing a healthy version. I think that's actually the future. I think that probably 5 years from now or some number of years from now, block producers are a large component of the block producers will be run by DACs that are groups that do some kind of sharing throughout their members. And, you know, I think that's where we're going. So we didn't want to like disable that in governance, but we did want to disable the unhealthy version. And if you're paying, if you're paying people for votes per vote, but your pay doesn't go up when you get more votes after a certain point, then it becomes a losing proposition economically for you. And so, you know, rather than have a rule about something, but then economics that incentivize that behavior, right? A rule against it and an economic incentive to do it. We decided to remove or mitigate the economic incentive to do it. And then we didn't need the rule.
Yeah. It's so much smarter too, because I mean, how can you possibly even define vote buying, and how can you enforce it? As an economist, it's one of those things. Let's just disincentivize it. Let's just make it so you're literally losing capital by vote buying, most likely. And I think you guys have nailed that. I really like it. I mean, you know, the number of improvements that I feel like TELOS has over the EOS mainnet are substantial. And you know, at first I was a bit dismissive, but as being someone who is curious and open-minded, the more I learn about this, the more I find myself having appreciation for TELOS just in general.
Ash, that seems to be the general consensus, because, and I think rightfully so, a lot of people were skeptical.
Yep.
Let's see what you deliver.
Yeah, for sure.
Delivered. And now people are like, huh, Wow, yeah. Nice job. Here's the gold star, you know, like
put a check mark by your name.
So I understand where that came from. And I think part of our job at EOS Detroit has been to help craft that narrative along the way. And I also like what Douglas was talking about earlier regarding a lot of the block producers becoming DACs. EOS Detroit actually operates like a DAC. We just are a traditional C corporation, but our ownership is liquid and dynamic like a DAC internally. And that's, you know, the pie that we use internally is the same type of model that we used in the TELOS launch group to incentivize the founding teams. And so implementing that model is so powerful. At EOS Detroit, we don't have any money to pay anyone. And everyone still shows up and works almost a full, full-time job on our team because they're all earning the skin in the game. And I think the same could be said for the TELOS launch group. We saw the launch group increase from maybe 25 to 30 individuals to over 70 by the end of it through implementing this bounty system model that allowed time and cash contributors to earn a slice of a fixed grant that was split between the founders. And that's, as Good Block or Douglas was saying earlier, that's where the Good Grant funds are coming from as well, is out of that TELOS founders rewards pool.
And I will say, sorry, Rob, I will say Go that, ahead. You know, kind of circling back to TELOS a little bit, is the reality is we didn't have the resources that Block One or EOS had. You know, we came forward with a concept that was based on accountability and fairness, and that we needed to work some things out, and that we were able to reach out and connect with people and develop. Actually, I think it's over, I want to say 120 some odd actual individuals that have kind of come forward over the last few months and working in a very grassroots kind of level to make this happen. I feel like I've done it a million times, but I'll never stop giving a shout out to every single person that participated in no matter how small a way and how large a way, because there's a very different dynamic to build that kind of community. And we're in the home stretch, but there's still a lot of work to do to kind of make the chain continue to be successful. So, but yeah, I mean, fairness and accountability is a really great foundation to build this type of thing from. And we did it with this group.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And speaking of foundations, Zane, you had messaged us in the chat here about the block producer agreement. You know, these are foundational type things. What did you want to ask about that?
I just wanted to ask Douglas or anyone, any three of you, just the improvements that you see with keeping accountability among block producers, having, since DPOS is voted for, we vote for the block producers, and having a system that also incentivizes block producers to help keep high quality among themselves. Could you talk a little bit about just your thoughts and approach to that? Because you'd mentioned it with voting, how to keep a block producer or somebody from voting for just themselves, and encouraging that growth of the community. I see this as another tool where you guys are really making a good step forward with that.
So yeah, no, Zane, that's a great observation and well spotted. So we saw that we had to work both ends towards the middle if we wanted to really solve this problem, because let's face it, this is the problems of EOS are not problems that exist because there's an easy solution. Their solutions are hard, right? We have so many smart people in the EOCO community. If these were easy, they'd be fixed. So we have to work everywhere. And one of the places we decided to look and work on was to take the actual behaviors of the block producers and codify them more. And so what we did is we actually, the only one of our governance documents that actually started out as a EOS document was the block producer, reg producer contract. We started with that, and that has a really good list of things that block producers shouldn't do, right? But that is essentially as far as it goes. There's no enforcement. If you really want to have something like that, what you have to do is you have to have the list of things you can't do, right? You have to have a list of penalties if somebody does do them, right? A method of enforcement of those penalties, and then a requirement that every participant actually take part in the enforcement, right? If any of those break down, you're eventually, it's not going to work, right? I mean, and we can't just make TELOS for this week, right? There's very easy to imagine a time in the future where nobody who launched it has any involvement with it anymore, right? I mean, at some point we're gonna all be getting dead. We'll be dead, and so, but even before that, you know, we may not stay on as block producers. I fully intend to, but you have to envision that this thing can't run on the good intentions of people, right? Of a founders group. It has to be self-incentivized. And so we added all four of those things to the reg producer agreement. And so there's actually really good functions of enforcement that are 100% decentralized still. That was the hardest thing. It's really easy to restrict, but it's hard to restrict in a decentralized way. And so a lot of our governance around that is based on writing that line. And I don't think there's any restrictions on that centralized TELOS at all. We've all held away from those. And you can read any of those governance documents at the website. They've been public since the first draft.
And just drop the link to the website real quick.
Yep. TELOSfoundation.io.
TELOSfoundation.io. Awesome. I'd love to talk about one more touchy subject since seeing that that's looks like what we do around here these days.
Yeah.
touchy.
Yeah.
Why not?
Worker proposal system. And this was something that was promised in the in Block One's white paper for EOS.io. And later Dan comes out and says, hey, let's just burn it all. And then I saw that, you know, there's a lot of people that have good arguments for it and a lot of people that have good arguments against it. And I think I have good arguments on both sides. So I think I'm straddling the fence right now. What's the idea of a WPS or a worker proposal system or fund in TELOS? And what's the consensus among all of you, since it's still kind of a small community? How do you think this is going to add value?
So I can't speak to how it's implemented in TELOS. Douglas, I'm sure you could speak a little more to that.
More socially speaking rather than the actual technical implementation.
Mm-hmm. So it's a pool of funds that grows and can be allocated by voters. I think one of the first worker proposal systems that I was aware of was actually launched in 2015 in BitShares 2.0. It actually took multiple years for that to start being tapped into, for the voters to figure out how to allocate it. And part of the reason Dan moved from BitShares to Steam was the fact that the voters didn't hire his worker proposal and he was running out of money. So I think worker proposals, we're now seeing full developer teams, and Dash is the shining example of a worker proposal system gone right, where they're actually bringing in thousands, tens of thousands of people and impressions to their project through strategic allocation of this capital. In EOS, I can see why it would be scary, given that we have some massive influences that who knows what their intentions are. In TELOS, because the voting dynamics will be so different, I think the worker proposal system will be a little safer from being raided, essentially, and that in all the positive benefits of worker proposal systems to enable the protocol to literally fund its own development is an amazing showcase. It really shows us the power of a DAC, because TELOS and EOS are both DACs as well. They're just like meta DACs. They're their own protocol and then other DACs can live on them. So
yep. DAX on DAX. DAX on DAX.
It can happen, guys. In fact, I'll give it over to Douglas to kind of talk more about specifically TELOS flavor of worker proposal system. But in general, it's a fantastic idea.
Yeah, thanks, Rob. Yeah, so yesterday at the EOS Ignite conference, I gave on governance, I gave a little talk entitled WPS funding, the lifeblood of chains. So that may give you some idea about where I stand on that. I, for quite some time, was a dark coin and then Dash Masternode owner. For a while, it was really cheap, and then it got really expensive, and now it's getting really cheap again. So come on in. Anyway, as a participant, as the owner of a few Masternodes there, I was very impressed with the system. I also got to see the problems with it, but we iterated over time, and it's I don't think there's anything about Dash that would make it the prominent coin that it is really without that ongoing development and ongoing money going into being split up amongst not only development but promotion, social works, things like that, that are still positive to the chain. I see this as probably the most long-term benefit, super secret benefit of TELOS. And that is that it's because if you think about it, we have had all these people like Rob and Beth were talking about working on TELOS for all the right reasons, but also people need to be paid. And they were working on it to be paid in TELOS from the TELOS Founders Rewards Pool. Well, that's done, right? It's over. So why are people going to keep working on it, right? If we don't give them a reason, then it's going to die, right? That's just basic economics. So we have to give them, people work for money. This just
the most
in.
Part, yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, they work for a lot of money.
Unless you're on Rob's team.
Yeah, no, well, they
then you work for too, slices. You
know? Yeah,
you work for dreams.
Anyone who thinks that's not true should try not getting paid. You know, at their job for and try and see how long their employees keep coming in. You have a special thing, but a special
there needs
case,
to be an incentive. Yeah, I mean, slices can imbue some value. So can some money. Obviously, does and I think. We can't expect block producers to be the only role that the network needs to hire.
Right.
So the network's hiring block producers, but should they really wear every single hat? Or can
and the answer is no, they should. Efficient? The network should hire, they should hire social media people. They should hire a marketing team in different regions. They should basically get insurance for their arbitrators so that you get high quality arbitrators. They should hire pretty much, onboarding administrative staff to reach out to work directly with exchanges and developers to get them to give them whatever support they need. But without those, I mean, these are all necessary functions. I know they are because we had of the 123 people who were onboarded in the TELOS Foundation group, 78 actually claimed rewards and did hours and hours and hours of work. And they did it in a lot of areas. So. We know that this is important. We know that these functions, even though the launch group is about to disband, these functions do not go away. So we have to figure out a way to get them going. And that's not even touching on development, right? Ongoing development. So we got to get the way to make this work is to have worker proposals. And block producers shouldn't be the only ones doing everything, right? Especially now, what you'll see is as the price goes down and we're seeing the pain on EOS mainnet about that, they're going to contract into more of their core block producer functions, which is what they should do, right? People are going to retrench until the price comes back up. And that's just, again, so much of this is just driven by basic economics and human nature and game theory and just very, very basic stuff.
Incentives.
It's all about
incentive models at the end of the day to make things go, whether that's encoded in your protocol or...
Sure, but what about when do we allow ourselves? So let's assume that this is how things are working with WPS. At what point can we offload some of this work onto the incentive of profit and of entrepreneurs being able to see the incentive of the profit
remove it
from the WPS?
There needs to be some level of standards. So what are the projects that need to be funded? What are the public works for the blockchain that maybe suffer a tragedy of commons if no one just steps up and does it because it's not the most profitable thing to do?
Right.
I think that's where the worker proposal system should be. If you look, I dropped a link to the BitShares Foundation worker proposal list. Mm-hmm. Just look at that. I mean, they've hired teams to actually put more nodes around the world. They've sponsored sponsored events. They've also hired a whole team of front end devs and hired backend devs to work on certain BitShares improvement proposals, and they're hiring someone to work on a mobile SDK. And it's all pegged to stable coins. So we can say this is $100,000 worth of work. And, you know, that's how sophisticated they've gotten. So they can actually peg it to a relatively stable unit of value and even kind of offload some of the risk of the volatility of the token price itself.
Right. I think it was a misunderstanding about there's actually two forms of this funding, right? One form is the TELOS Foundation, which started out with an endowment of a fund of 6 million tokens, which will deplete if not refunded, because you didn't want to put them in forever. But the TELOS Foundation will be more about saying, hey, we need to do this. Let's get some money into that. We need to do this. Let's get some money into that. And then they are very likely to come back to the worker proposal system, which is based on 1.5% inflation, annual inflation, that drips in block by block into EOCO.savings contract. That though is entirely funded. It's by the users. There's no committee, right? So on some of these have like sort of a committee, like Rob's discussing, like the EOS suggestion right now says, hey, we need to, you know, make sure that we're only doing these important things. On TELOS, that's not the way it is at all. Any user can make a proposal. There's a small fee to keep
spam and such.
Yeah, exactly. That can be refunded if it hits a threshold. And there's a voting threshold that's needed. But if anything gets a simple majority and more than 5% of the votable tokens voting, it wins, right? In this way, the community actually decides where they want the chain to go. How much to put, you know, and I think that since it's their money, it's their influence, it's their inflation, they're going to pick well. People are excited about features like getting, you know, taking IPFS on TELOS from being implemented, but only used right now for governance documents. I know that people want to get that moved up so that apps and users can use that, because it's amazing advantage for everybody involved, right? So GoodBlock and the rest of our devs and the rest of the devs are going to work on building that out immediately after launch, and we will probably, you know, then we will ask for a work proposal. We'll do submit a work proposal proposal in order to get repaid. But mostly what's going to happen is what happens on Dash and everywhere else. There's going to be ongoing payments, proposals to get paid for the next quarter, right? And that just keeps everybody, that it keeps everybody in the system. It attracts a better level of developer. It means that developers who have like really cool ideas and they want to deploy have a way to get the community to fund them without going through, you know, any centralized body. But for some things where a centralized body is helpful, you know, we have the TELOS Foundation that can kind of do that outreach and say, hey, Code Red, this probably doesn't pay as well as it should. And so, but we really need it. So let's get some people going on there. And then the foundation as a whole can say, hey, we do these 15 things for you guys. If you want us to keep going in the next quarter, we're going to need this much. And those may be easier to socialize than the onesie twosie projects that are so important for the chain.
Yeah, important to note that the TELOS Foundation is also a DAC.
Right.
So okay. That's going to be elected and cool. All driven through smart contracts, as far as I know.
It is. It's basically
go ahead.
Yeah, two things there that I heard that I appreciate. One is that in BitShares, and I hope to see TELOS and EOS Mainnet do this, is that the WPSs are tied to stable coins. And I know the word stable coin irritates people because the dollar's not stable. It's lost 95% of its value since the Federal Reserve and all this, but it's stable for buying bread for the most part. But
relatively stable.
Relative to life. You know, one thing that I saw in Dash that I knew was a weakness was when Amanda B. Johnson was getting like 100 Dash a week for her podcast. And all of a sudden that was like $25,000 a week that she was getting because she had a 3-month contract or something. So I do hope that we see like normal currencies, if you will, stable fiat currencies for now. And I don't want to hear my libertarian friends come at me with this. Just stop it. Don't email me. But, you know, I think that's an improvement. The other thing is, as an entrepreneur, as a Liberty entrepreneur, as someone who is a capitalist and loves the feedback loop of profit in the marketplace, knowing that some of these things are, you know, like a one-off type of, Douglas, you had something earlier where it's a temporary economy, I think you coined it, where it's, you know, more contractual based. Yes, okay, we're not going to pay you ongoing for 6 months. Like, we think this is going to take 3 months, and let's agree on that. And that's the terms of this, especially for infrastructure spending. I think it was Saeed, because I was very skeptical of WPS, but I come from Dash and I love WPS, and I've given presentations on voluntary inflation, which this obviously is. So I'm glad that all of you are really taking some serious time to think about how this can add value. Because at the end of the day, if you're using inflation and it's actually adding value for the community, then it was a good investment. I think the fear for a lot of libertarians is that we're so scared of inflation because it only creates value for the government and doesn't create value for the common people, that we're just going to reproduce that system. Douglas, tell us about, let's start wrapping up here. Tell us about the Squirrel Wallet, which is an awesome name, by the way. I used to use Squirrel Mail back in the day. But just wrap up here about expectations. I know you are currently going through your launch sequence. What should end users expect? How can they get the wallet? How can they start interacting? How can they vote? And if you can give us any inside information on when you expect the first apps, hopefully gaming apps, to start coming online.
Thank you. Wow. That's a lot. So how do you get on and vote? Well, or how do you get on and use a wallet? The current version of Squirrel 5.3 is on, you can download that from the telosfoundation.io website. It works great. Not only can you do all the normal types of wallet things that you could do, you can and vote for BPs and proxies and things like that. It also has all the governance is built right in there. So you can see these, and it's kind of exciting if you're a nerd, because those are all served up from IPFS, which is kind of cool. It's a really good advancement for the network. So, but if you want to get on, go get Squirrel. The Scatter 10 current beta also fully supports Telos chain. It's great. So there will be links, and looks like Meow is also going to, which is a ledger of variant, is going to be working for Telos as well. So it looks like we have three really good options as well. I've heard that that Gray Mass EOS voter is right behind. Squirrel is actually a very friendly cooperative fork with them that Marlon Williams at TELOS Miami did, and they were able to use some of those advancements so that EOS voter will also get on there. So we're going to have a lot of wallets. Once we activate, which I think is going to be, you know, well, once we launch and validate the network, then people are going to be able to get on and check their balances and all kinds of things, which I think will be really fun. I think there's a lot of people, there's about 200 people who had their lost or stolen keys recovered that have never been able to use them on EOS, who we did a recovery process for, and who are going to be able to use it, those accounts, for the first time on Telos. Nice. So get on board, and dapps are absolutely coming. I mean, I have no worries. The one I'm very excited about is called Chestnut.
Yeah, I may know something or two about that one.
Yeah, we should ask you. But it's there will be a lot, and I think gaming apps are you know, great. My eyes are on where are the more useful apps going to, you know, more sort of mainstream apps going to come in. Nothing against the gaming apps, but
there's nothing more mainstream than video.
I'm more interested in Edna and Eva and Chestnut and you know, a bunch of things like that. We're gonna be launching DAC Lab right away, which is basically that's gonna be like Q1 of 19. Like, it's because that's something that lets any kind of organization build a DAC for themselves. It's basically the same technology that we use to build the Telos Foundation, and wish we'd had for for the TELOS launch group. So we're going to be able to spin that out to a lot of people. So these things are coming. I leave it to the DAP, to the app developers to do their own announcements. I'm not here to out anyone, but you will see a lot for all the economic reasons that we talked about, why an app would deploy on TELOS. They are going to deploy on TELOS.
For sure. There's no doubt. I mean, especially with the TELOS grants or whatever, the good grants, if you offer people opportunity, then people are going to seize that, and you're going to see people building who knows what. That's the best part of the marketplace. We don't know.
I'm excited. I can't wait. That's actually something I'm very excited. After launch, we are going to be able to talk about who the first good grant recipients are going to be. And it's there. A lot of them are like exactly the ones you'd hope. It's like, oh, they're, you know, it's education, or it's in the third world, or it's, you know, or it's this is a great thing that could never actually go without the money, or
and account management. Hopefully, I mean, you know, I'm no longer a day to day part of Chestnut, but we need to pull people over who can feel comfortable and convenient using and you know, safe using their accounts. And this was the whole
it's
idea
huge. Behind Chestnut. It's huge. Absolutely. And I don't want to create this idea that this is only for small apps that would never be able to deploy at all. We want every size app. And just because somebody has funding or something like that, there's still an enormous good that comes to the TELOS community by staking for them. The resources are there. So I don't care how high level, how prominent something is, they're going to, you know, we want to stake for them. We want to give them, you know, those tokens. We feel there's plenty there. So, you know, they should come to us. Why not?
Yep.
So as an app developer, it feels great to have choices.
Oh, I'm sure. Right. I mean, you can, and choices on blockchains that you can actually use and deploy on, not some of these proof of work chains where it's too expensive and too slow, you know?
Oh yeah. I don't want to burn my whole budget trying to make performance workarounds.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I really appreciate everyone coming on EOS.radio today. It's been a wonderful panel. You know, I created this so that we can have this panel type of discussion, because whenever I was at conferences, the best part of the conferences were always the panels. And so I love getting so many different people's perspectives on things, devs or non-devs, right? Because we're all in this together, and you guys completely have my support. I love what you're doing. You know, Zane and I talk about EOS all day, every day, it seems like. And our opinion of what TELOS is doing is nothing but positive at this point. And I hope any of the listeners go check out telosfoundation.io. Go to telosfoundation.io/downloads and check out the Squirrel wallet, because this baby is going to be live soon. And it's really exciting, and I can't wait to see what gets built on it. And that's it. Just thank you so much for coming on today. Beth, Douglas,
thanks for having us.
It's been a real pleasure. Zane, thank you as always, my lovely co-host.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
And don't forget to vote for the Freedom Proxy back here. I don't even know if you can read that. It's so small, but
I wore the shirt.
for now, every EOS.radio is sponsored by the Freedom Proxy, and by sponsored, I mean just said. So thank everyone for coming on. And Douglas, I think I heard you say DAP.
I did. Yeah, it slips out sometimes. DAP slips out sometimes.
Kind of like ATM machine.
Yeah.
ATM. I cannot claim to be perfect. You know?
Automated teller machine. All right. Well, this.
Look forward to seeing TELOS launched over the next couple days. It's coming.
We will for sure be keeping up with it. I love the timeliness of this panel. So I hope the TELOS community finds value in it. Non-TELOS community, I hope, finds value in it. Becomes part of the TELOS community. And let's see if we can get some retweets and shares of this. It's been a lot of fun, all of you. Thank you.
It's all one community.
Thanks, everybody.
I mean, let's be honest.
Yep.
We're all one community.
For
the
sure.
EOS.io global village.
No doubt. We're taking over the world, EOS.io. Yep. Or as Douglas says, EOSCO or something like
that. EOSCO.
EOSCO. All right. I'll stop picking on Douglas. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Have a great rest of your
day.
Thanks,
Zane.
Yeah, signing out. See you, everyone.